بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد عبده ورسول. الحمد لله, I'm not scheduled even to be on the speaker tour here with Sheikh Muhammad Salah. I just dropped by because he invited me to drop in. So before we do anything else, I'd just like to share a little quick story with you. Then we're going to have Sheikh give us the story of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, inshaAllah, radiallahu anhu. Now, there's a story that, a more recent story of one of those great thinkers about 100 years ago or so, back at the time maybe of Einstein, when people were coming up with these great ideas of things and science and so on. And one of these scientists who was very famous at the time had come up with this great theory about something, and people were so impressed, and everywhere he went they couldn't wait to come out and ask him questions and learn more about this particular area of science. And it happened that he hated flying. And in those days, flying was just in, you know, those open planes. So he was afraid of that. So he had a driver take him everywhere he went. And he used to go from university to university speaking. And the same driver taking him everywhere, you know. Finally, one day, the driver was saying his whole speech, his whole entire speech. And he sat there listening, and when it was finished, he said, "Driver, I didn't know you were a scientist." He said, "I'm not. In fact, I don't know anything about science." He said, "You just said my whole speech." He said, "It's the exact same speech you say every single place you go. It was easy, I just memorized it." He said, "Could you do that in front of people?" He said, "Sure, why not? I watched you for so many times." He said, "Yeah, I wish you could handle the questions." He said, "Give me any question." So he gave him some questions. He answered all the questions. "How do you know the answer to the questions?" He said, "Because it's the same exact questions you get every time too." He said, "Trade caps with me." "What?" He said, "You take my hat, I want your cap. Because I'm tired tonight, I just want to relax. I'm going to drive and pull into the university, see what happens." So they did. They switched caps, and when they pulled into the university, the people saw, oh, this must be, you know, the one in the back, he must be the big scientists. So they took the scientist driver in and put him up on the stage, and he gave the whole speech. Meantime, the driver scientist is sitting in the back watching the whole thing, smiling. He gave the speech perfectly, and the people were, and then they stood up with a question, and they asked the same questions as always, and he got the same answers from the driver scientist. And what do you think happened? Just at the very end, one lady, she stood up, she said, "Sir, I have a question," and she asked a question never been asked in front of the driver before. He said, "Madam, your question is a dumb question. Your question is so easy, I'm going to let my driver answer it." And with that, I'd like to introduce my driver.
Can you give me your cap?
We did that. We, Sheikh Jaffer and I did that right after it. You have to trade.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم, من همزه ونفخه ونفثه. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى, وسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى, لا سيما المصطفى صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. ثم أما بعد, praise be to Allah alone, we praise him and we seek his help. Whomsoever Allah guides is a truly guided one, and whomsoever Allah leaves astray, no one can show him guidance. May the best peace and blessings be upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Dear brothers and sisters, in the next few minutes, inshaAllah, and in the company of my best friend and Shaykh, Shaykh Yusuf Issis, inshaAllah, we're going to discuss a little bit about the biography and the verses of the greatest companion ever, the second greatest man in this ummah after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, according to the Quran and the Sunnah and the statement of the companions, all of them, radiyallahu anhum jami'an. That is indeed no one other than Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, radiyallahu anhu. And once again, we had the pleasure of listening to the great Qari' Sheikh Tamir, who recited in the first raka'ah of Maghrib Surat, ها ها ده آيات في سورة السيد والذي جاء بالصدق وصدق به أولئك هم المتقون لهم ما يشاءون عند ربهم ذلك جزاء المحسنين. This ayat in what surah? Surah Az-Zumar, ayah number 33. وَالَّذِي جَاءَ بِالصَّدِقِ وَصَدَّقَ بِهِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ. The Shaykh is telling us this ayah was revealed pertaining the great companion Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. الَّذِي جَاءَ بِالصَّدِقِ, the one who brought the truth is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the one who believed in him and followed him first, وَصَدَّقَ بِهِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ. So Abu Bakr al-Siddiq and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam were joined and combined in this ayah. لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِمْ. The reward with the Lord is whatever they desire. ذَلِكَ جَزَاءُ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. That is the compensation of the good doers. So in Surah Az-Zumar, in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praises Abu Bakr, whose name is Abdullah ibn Uthman ibn Amir. And his kunya, or nickname, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. He was given this name, al-Siddiq, because of this ayah. الَّذِي جَاءَ بِالصُّدِقِ وَصَدَّقَ بِهِ. Two incidents made him al-Siddiq. The first one, because Abu Bakr radiyallahu an was the first one to accept Islam. The first Muslim of all men. Because once the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam invited him and he told him that he got the wahi in the cave, he did not hesitate to believe in him, to follow him, and to testify to the oneness of Allah and that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last messenger of Allah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, there is not a single person whom I invited to Islam, but kana lahu kabwa. Yani, he was either reluctant or hesitant, or he asked further questions except for one person, Abu Bakr. Once the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, he accepted Islam at first. فَكَانَ أَوَّلَ مَنْ أَسْلَمَ مِنَ الرِّجَالِ. Then, years later, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam on the 10th year was taken during Aam al-Huzn on a night journey of al-Isra, then al-Mi'raj to heaven, and he returned, and in the morning he gathered the Meccans and he told them about this miracle that he went to Jerusalem and he returned back in the same night and he went to heaven, etc. People started making fun of him. Abu Jahl withdrew. He knew what he was doing. He ran to Abu Bakr, he knocked on his door and said, Ya Abu Bakr, did you hear what your friend is saying? He said, what did he say? He said, your friend lost his mind. Your friend claims that he went to Jerusalem last night, Jerusalem in Palestine. We traveled 1 month going and 1 month coming back. And furthermore, he went to heaven and he returned while his bed was still warm. He said, really? Did he say so? He said, yes, I swear. He said, well, if he says so, then he's telling the truth. Then this happened.
He did it.
And this is the truth. He did it! He said, man, أصدقه. I believe in him in the matter of the heaven that God sends an angel to him. And he gave him a message and he reveals to him, wouldn't I believe him in the matter of the earth that he traveled between Mecca and Jerusalem in no time? أصدقه في أمر السماء فلا أصدقه في أمر الأرض. And that's why it has been confirmed that Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه is the ultimate صديق. Then in the next rak'ah, the second rak'ah, he also recited some ayat pertaining Abu Bakr صديق. What surah was it? Surah Al-Layl, right? What were the ayat? أما من أعطى واتقى وصدق بالحسنى فسنيسره لليسرى. As for him who gives in charity, who fears Allah, who believes in the last day and in al-husna in al-jannah. فَسَنُ يَسِّرُهُ لِلْيُسْرَى. We shall make his path to al-jannah easy. And then by the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا لِأَحَدٍ عِنْدَهُ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ تُجِزَى إِلَّا بِتِغَاءَ وَجِهِ رَبِّهِ الْأَعْلَى وَلَا سَوْفَ يَرْضَى. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq was doing all of that just to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As certainly Allah is pleased with him, and certainly Allah will please him on the day of judgment. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq used to purchase the slaves, those who accepted Islam and were weak and oppressed, out of his free money and set them free. Bilal ibn Rabah and others. So his father one day told him, son, why are you wasting your money? You can buy the strong and powerful servants, slaves, so that they can assist you. He said, father, I'm not buying them for this. I'm buying them to free them for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا لِأَحَدٍ عِنْدَهُ مِنْ نِعْمَةٍ تُجْزَى إِلَّا ابْتِغَاءَ وَجْهِ رَبِّهِ الْأَعْلَى وَلَسَوْفَ يَرْضَى. Then the Quran was revealed once again in Surah At-Tawbah pertaining Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. Which ayah? إِلَّا تَنْصُرُوهُ فَقَدْ نَصَرَهُ اللَّهُ. If you're not going to support him, Allah will, because he did support him. When and where? إِذْ أَخْرَجَهُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا ثَانِيَ اثْنَيْنِ إِذْ هُمَا فِي الْغَارِ إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ لَا تَحْزَنْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا. Remember when the kuffar of Mecca drove him out. Remember when there were only two of them in the cave of Thawb, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah chose for him from amongst mankind the best of the best, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, his best companion, the chosen one by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then by his prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses every word and letter carefully. It's the divine word. إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ لَا تَحْزَنْ. He didn't say لَا تَخَفْ. Some people misinterpret it as that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Abu Bakr, don't you be afraid. No, it doesn't say that. Abu Bakr was not afraid. The ayah says, remember when he said to his companion, Abu Bakr, the Prophet said to Abu Bakr, what did he say? لَا تَحْزَنْ. Don't be sad. Why? Because Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, when they were sitting like that in the cave, and the Meccans were trying to chase them, he saw them standing by the opening of the cave. So he said, Ya Rasulullah, لَوْ نَظَرَ أَحَدُهُمْ تَحْتَ قَدَمِهِ أَوْ إِلَى قَدَمِهِ لَرَآنَا. If any of them bothered to look down to his feet, they would see us. So the Prophet ﷺ said, لَا تَحْزَنْ, don't be sad. He knew that Abu Bakr was not afraid. He was sad that he was worried that if they ever captured them, it would be over. The message would be over. They may hurt the Prophet ﷺ. That's why pertaining this incident, at the time of Umar ibn Khattab, when he was the Khalifa, some people were talking about who's the best of this ummah. So some people said in his presence, oh, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Umar ibn Khattab. Said, what are you talking about? Rather, it is As-Siddiq. He's the best of the best after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I remember how Allah praised him and admired him, especially during the journey of the Hijrah, when he chose for his prophet the best companion, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, to accompany him. He did not choose anybody else but Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. Furthermore, he narrated, this is what Umar al-Khattab is telling us, remember, as they were migrating and escaping, and Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, while walking with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sometimes will jump and walk in front of him. Then all of a sudden, will it change his mind and will go and walk behind the Prophet. Then another time, will go to the right, then to the left. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam realized that Abu Bakr al-Siddiq keep rotating around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, what is the matter? He said, Ya Rasulullah, every time I remember at-talab, I remember that some people are trying to chase us. So I stay behind you. If anything happens, if anybody hits you with an arrow, I will take it instead. Then if I remember that they may come from the front, I go to the front. From the right, from the left, and so on. Then when they reached the cave, he said, wait, Ya Rasulullah. Then he entered. He entered the deserted cave first to make sure that it doesn't have any scorpions or snakes or harmful insects that may harm or hurt the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He found some holes indicating that it has some scorpions. Say Alhamdulillah. Yarhamukumullah. If you sneeze, you gotta say Alhamdulillah out loud, because if you do not say it out loud, you don't deserve to hear Yarhamukumullah. And this is in the Sunnah. إذا حمد الله شمت. So you gotta say Alhamdulillah so that we can say Yarhamukumullah. Okay. It is very important that when we pass by anything, to remind one another with the Sunan. This is not to teach somebody a lesson, rather this is for all of us. So he plugged all the holes with his clothes, he tore it apart, and he kept plugging. And one hole he couldn't plug it, so he sat on top of it. And the Prophet ﷺ entered the cave, and he placed his head over his thigh, and he took a nap. The Prophet ﷺ is full of comfort and confidence. He trusts Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so he went to sleep. And Abu Bakr was worried about the Prophet ﷺ, not about himself, because he has exposed his life before to death several times for the sake of the deen. So he is not afraid of dying for the sake of Allah, but he's worried about the Prophet ﷺ and his security. And then that hole which he plugged by his foot, a scorpion came and bit him out of that. He was dying of the pain, but he didn't want to alert the Prophet ﷺ or awaken. He was crying. So one of the tears, one of the drops, fell on the cheek of the Prophet ﷺ, and that awakened the Prophet. What is the matter? Are you crying? He realized that he got bitten. So he prayed for him and he was cured innocently. So Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anh says, by Allah, this single night which Abu Bakr al-Siddiq joined the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and during the journey and did all of that is better than Umar ibn al-Khattab and the family of Umar ibn al-Khattab, the entire family and their entire life. Are you holding a comparison between me and Abu Bakr al-Siddiq? This single life night is better than the whole family of al-Khattab and their entire life. Radiallahu anhu. Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya, one of the sons of Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiallahu anhu, once asked him, who's the best of this ummah? After the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, Abu Bakr, of course. He said, then whom? He said, and Umar ibn Khattab is next. Before he would ask him about the third, he said, then I believe you're the third. He said, me? I'm just one of the Muslimin. I'm an ordinary person. Look at the tawadu'. Zainul Abideen, Ali, the son of Al-Husayn, the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib. So he is one of the great grandchildren of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Once, one of the so-called Shia came to him and said, tell me a little bit about this guy. He said, which guy? He said, Abu Bakr. He said, you mean a Siddiq? He said, do you call him a Siddiq? He said, why shall I not call him the Siddiq? While the one who's much better than me, who's the best, have called him the Siddiq. وَالَّذِي جَاءَ بِالصَّدْقِ وَصَدَّقَ بِهِ أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْمُتَّقُونَ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam have called him as-Siddiq. You don't want me to call him as-Siddiq? There is no way that one can enter al-Jannah if he does not believe that Abu Bakr is as-Siddiq of this ummah. And listen to this. Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhu once was deployed by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the commander of an expedition. It was Ghazwat Dhat al-Salasil. He returned victorious and he wanted to hear some words of praise and admiration from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and get a voucher from him. So he returned to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, he just returned from the battle victorious. He said, Ya Rasulullah, man ahabbu an-nasi ilayk? Whom do you love the most? The Prophet ﷺ said right away, Aisha. said, no, 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 I don't mean of women. I mean of men, you know? They said, her father. He said, then whom? He said, then Umar. He said, then whom? He said, Uthman. Then whom? And he said, Ali. He said, then I stopped asking. In the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the way out of the fitan and the trouble is, عليكم بسنتي وسنتي الخلفاء الراشدين. He said, إنهم من يعش منكم بعدي, for those who will survive me and live after me, they shall live to find and go through fitan and trying. فسيرى اختلافا كثيرا. Lot of differences and confusions. They said, what is the way out, Ya Rasulullah? He said, stick to my sunnah and the sunnah of the rightly guided khulafa after me. Abu Bakr, wa Umar, wa Uthman, wa Ali, may Allah be pleased with all of them. Those are the companions whom the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praised. He said, khayrun nasi qarni, as Imam al-Bukhari collected. The best of mankind is my generation. How can anyone dare to judge the iman of Abu Bakr or Umar? How can anyone dreams of entering Al-Jannah if he has a problem with Abu Bakr or Umar? After all what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about them in the Quran, particularly As-Siddiq, in Surah An-Nur. So how many ayahs so far did we mention pertaining Abu Bakr? Huh? Three. Surah Az-Zumr. Surah Al-Tawbah. Surah Al-Layl. Then in Surah An-Nur. وَلَا يَأْتَلِ أُولُو الْفَضْلِ مِنْكُمْ وَالسَّعَةِ أَنْ يُؤْتُوا أُولِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَالْمُهَاجِرِينَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَنْ يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. This ayah was revealed also concerning Abu Bakr al-Siddiq. I heard Sheikh Asim last time was talking about Mistah, the one who's involved in the slander, who talked bad about Aisha radiallahu anha. Then he was punished, Hadd al-Qadf. It's ajeeb that Mistah was supported on regular basis by Aisha's father. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq is the one who used to support him financially. He was paying him on monthly basis his salary. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the bara'a and the innocence of Aisha radiallahu anha, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq said, this is it. I ain't giving you anything anymore. He stopped. He did not blame him. He did not beat him up. He did not have any problem with him. But he said, I cannot support him financially after what he did to my daughter, who happened to be the mother of the believers, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Quran is revealed to say, let not those whom Allah bestowed with wealth and bounty swear against giving in charity the masakeen and the muhajireen. وَلْيَعْفُوا وَلْيَصْفَحُوا. Let them pardon and forgive. أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَنْ يَغْفَرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Don't you like Allah to forgive your sins? Right away, Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, he said, certainly, Ya Rabb. I love to be forgiven. I love you to pardon me. And he resumed his help. Look at this deen. Can this happen anywhere else but in Islam?
No.
Can this happen anywhere else but among the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Somebody insults your daughter and accuses her with the fahisha, and you still support him? And you still give him money?
No.
Why? أَلَا تُحِبُّونَ أَن يَغْفِرَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. Of course we love. Subhanallah. This is the best ummah, and this is the best generation, and those are our role models. Ibn al-Jawzi, may Allah have mercy on him, said, the Salaf, Ridwanullahi alayhim, our predecessors, used to teach their children the love of the companions of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, same way that they used to teach them the surah of the Quran. So teaching them and learning and studying the biography and the lifestyle of the Sahaba and how much they love the Prophet ﷺ and their sacrifices is as important as studying the Quran. Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu narrated that One day, as we were leaving the masjid, a Bedouin came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "Ya Rasulullah, mata as-sa'a? When is the day of judgment? When will it take place?" The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam turned to him and he answered his question with a question. He said, "And what have you prepared for it?" He said, "Wallahi, I did not do much of prayers or fasting. I'm not really proactive in that. He barely offers the fard. غَيْرَ أَنِّي أُحِبُّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ But wallahi, ya Rasulullah, my heart is full of love to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is this an act of worship? That is the best and the foremost act of worship. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned to him and said, أَنْتَ مَعْ مَنْ أَحْبَبْتْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ Abshir, rejoice. You will be with those whom you love on the Day of Judgment. Anas ibn Malik said, by Allah, we never heard any better statement or good news after accepting Islam than this statement. Then he says right away, Anas ibn Malik says, by Allah, I love Allah and I love His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and I love Abu Bakr and Umar, hoping that I will be gathered with them even though I cannot catch up with their good deeds. So the love of those companions, brothers and sisters, does bring us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and is indeed a great act of worship. Abu Bakr Siddiq has unlimited favors upon this ummah. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before his death said to Aisha radiallahu anha, when he was so sick, "Call Abu Bakr." Why? He said, "Tell him to lead the prayer." When the imam deputizes somebody else to lead the prayer, what does it mean? He's the second best. He's the man who's next in order. But Aisha radiallahu anha, with a very smart woman, she did not want this to happen so that the companions would have a bad omen that Abu Bakr is replacing the Prophet in his life or is sending a wrong message. She said, "Ya Rasulullah, Abu Bakr, rajulun asif." By the way, one of the names or the titles of Abu Bakr was Al-Awwah and Al-Atiq. Al-Awwah was a divine description to Ibrahim alayhi salam. Inna Ibrahim la-awwahun halim. His heart is very soft. That was Abu Bakr also. Awwah. Anything will make him cry, especially when he reads the Quran. She said, "Ya Rasulullah, Abu Bakr, rajulun asif, raqiq al-qalb." If he reads the Quran, he starts crying and people will not even understand what he's reciting. He said, "Order Abu Bakr to lead the prayer." She repeated the same statement. Said, "You are sawahibu Yusuf. You are the women. You want to do what you have in mind. Listen to me and order Abu Bakr Siddiq to lead the prayer." So he led the prayer. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, and when the companions were puzzled whom to choose after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there came Umar ibn Khattab in the Thaqifah. He raised the hand of Abu Bakr and he said, "I give bay'ah to the one whom Allah and His Messenger chose him to succeed the Prophet in the prayer." Who led the salah in the absence of the Prophet, when the Prophet was sick? The Prophet entrusted whom to lead the prayer? Abu Bakr Siddiq. And that was a very straightforward indication that Abu Bakr Siddiq should succeed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in leading the ummah after his death. A woman came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his death and his sickness right before his death, and she had a mas'ala. Then she had to come for a follow-up. She said, "Ya Rasulullah, when shall I come back?" He said, "If you can find me, then you will find Abu Bakr as-Siddiq." Then you will find Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Look at the Abu Bakr and his status. He said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "No one have done us any favor, but we paid him back. I compensated every and each person who's done me a favor, except one person, Abu Bakr. I can never pay him enough. I can never compensate him for all what he did. وَسَانِي بِمَالِهِ His entire wealth was at my service." He believed in me when everybody else rejected me. That's why when he once had a conflict with Umar ibn Khattab, and Abu Bakr al-Siddiq realized that it was his fault. So he went to Umar ibn Khattab. But Umar ibn Khattab did not accept his apology. So Abu Bakr went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and said, Ya Rasulullah, I went to Umar and I asked him to forgive me. Umar ibn Khattab right away went to Abu Bakr's house. When he knew that he came to him, he didn't find him. So he ran to the masjid. And there Abu Bakr was sitting before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and telling him what happened. Umar walked in and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very angry. He said, beware of hurting Abu Bakr. He's my intimate friend. Leave me alone with my best friend. Leave me alone with my best friend. Abu Bakr Siddiq kept saying, Ya Rasulullah, it was my fault. It was my mistake. He said, don't you ever dare to harm Abu Bakr anymore. After that, no one would do anything to upset Abu Bakr Siddiq. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ made it very clear. Abu Bakr is special. Abu Bakr is loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said in one hadith that if I have not taken Allah as my Khalil, as an intimate friend, I would have taken Abu Bakr Siddiq as a Khalil. He's the chosen best companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Do you think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would let the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam choose any person? Or he will choose for him? He would definitely choose for him. Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam allowed the companions to migrate to Al-Habasha, decided to migrate. So he set out. And on the way, as he was leaving Mecca, one of the Meccan chiefs by the name Ibn al-Dighinna met him and said, what are you up to? He said, I'm making hijrah. He said, astaghfirullah. How can a person like you in your position leave Mecca? By Allah, you are in my protection. And he took him back. And he stood before the Kaaba and he said, Ya Ahl Mecca, this man is a man of honor. This man helps the weak. This man honors the guest. This man should not leave Mecca under any circumstances. He is in my protection. So Abu Jahl and Umay ibn Khalaf and others came to him and said, well, we will honor your protection, but you have to ask him that he should not recite the Quran out loud. Why? Because he's a fitna. When he recites the Quran, he makes our women and its children race to listen to him. They could not resist his beautiful recitation. So he made a commitment with him. He said, Ya Abu Bakr, if you want to read the Quran, if you want to pray, pray at home, not in public. He said, okay. Then he could not resist the urge of establishing a musalla at his house. Then he started reciting at home, but with a melodious and out loud voice. So the youth and the women started going to Abu Bakr Siddiq's house, and it has become like a monument. Everybody was going there. So they went to Ibn al-Dighinna and said, look at that, this is what we're afraid of. Everybody is going to listen to the recitation of Abu Bakr. Whenever Abu Bakr Siddiq recited the Quran, he would cry. Why? Because he understood the Quran. He knew that he's reading the word of Allah. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam died, look at the understanding. Umar ibn Khattab could not imagine that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is dead. He took his sword out and he said, anyone who dares to say that the Prophet is dead, I will chop off his head. The Prophet went for a meeting with his Lord, like Musa alayhi wa sallam, and he will come back. And he will cut the tongues and the heads of those who said that he died. He stopped people from saying that the Prophet is dead. Can you imagine? And you know who is Umar ibn Khattab. There came Abu Bakr al-Siddiq from out of town. He entered upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, uncovered his face, and he placed a kiss over his forehead when he recognized that he was officially dead. Then he said, "Tibta hayyan wa mayyitan ya Rasulullah." You're always good, whether you are alive or dead. Then he covered his face back. He stepped out. And Umar al-Khattab was going crazy. He took his hand and said, Ya Umar! Stop it. Calm down. Didn't you hear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, وما محمد إلا رسول قد خلت من قبله الرسل أفإن مات أو قتل انقلبتم على أعقابكم ومن ينقلب على عقبيه فلن يضر الله شيئا وسيجزي الله الشاكرين. He reminded him with an ayah that Umar read it awfully. Muhammad is just one of the messengers. Whether he is killed or he died naturally, would you then turn away from the deen? Muhammad delivered the message. وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبْ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْءٍ. Umar bin Khattab said, Subhanallah, it's like I've never read this ayah before. Look at the wisdom of Abu Bakr al-Siddiq and how he handled this situation. It's a very tough situation. And that's why in another serious test on the Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah, when the Prophet ﷺ have seen in a dream that he was performing Umrah after Ghazwat al-Ahzab, so he told his companions that let's go to perform Umrah. They all put on their ihram and they set out. Approaching Mecca at a place called Al-Hudaybiyah, the Meccans stopped them. And his sheikh camel knelt down and it won't move. The Prophet ﷺ said, by Allah, I shall accept any deal that the Meccans agree with me to. So they came after negotiations and so on. And they made a deal which is known as the Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah. All the terms of the treaty were unfair to Muslims. That Muslims are not going to perform Umrah this year. They have to return back. Come on, we came with the ihram. And we're not taking the plane. We're traveling for days. And we're just coming to perform Umrah. Let us perform Umrah, then we'll leave. No. Okay? Ego. Pride. You have to get a permission first in order to enter Mecca. You may come back next year. The Prophet agreed. Oh, if any person from Mecca wanted to accept Islam and he managed to migrate and go to Muhammad, Muslims are not allowed to host him. They have to send him back. And if any person from the Muslims decided to convert from Islam to idolism, Muslims should not stop him from doing so. And so on and so forth. All the terms were unfair. The companions were disappointed and objected. And Umar al-Khattab was amongst them. The Prophet ﷺ said to his companions, even when they were writing the treaty, Ali ibn Abi Talib was writing, and the Prophet ﷺ, with the person who was negotiating with him from the Meccan side, the Prophet ﷺ said to Ali, write down Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This guy said, no, we don't believe in ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Write down Bismika Allahumma. The Prophet ﷺ said to Ali, write down Bismika Allahumma. This is what Muhammad, the messenger of Allah, had agreed to with the Meccans. The guy objected and said, no, I don't believe that you are a messenger of Allah. To begin with, erase it. Ali said, I'm not going to erase it. The Prophet ﷺ said, show it to me. What is it? Because he was illiterate. So Ali pointed out and he erased it by his own hand, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and said, Ya Ali, you may have to do something similar to it one day. And it happened. And it happened during the reconciliation between him and Muawiyah radiallahu anhum jami'an. So anyway, after they concluded the treaty, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam now ordered them to slaughter their hajj and shave their heads. Why? Because we didn't complete the Umrah, we're returning, so we have to undo our ihram. Everybody objected. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam entered to his tent and Umm Salama was there. He said, halak al-qawm. My people will be destroyed. They disobeyed my command, including Umar ibn Khattab. Umar ibn Khattab went to Abu Bakr al-Siddiq and said, Ya Abu Bakr, do you see what's happening? Aren't we Muslims? Don't we believe in Allah? He said, yes. Isn't he the true messenger of Allah? Yes. Aren't these the kuffar? Yes. So, alama nu'ti ad-daniyata fi dinina, yarhamukumullah. Why do we have to give up on our deen? Abu Bakr al-Siddiq, the wisest of this ummah after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, Ya Umar, calm down. He's a messenger of Allah and he knows what he's doing. Ilzam gharza. stick to what he does. Stick to what he does. So while everybody else was going crazy, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq once again proves that he is the ultimate Siddiq of this ummah. So the Prophet ﷺ went out and he shaved his head and all the companions followed him. This treaty, which seemed unfair, upon concluding this treaty, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, إِنَّا فَتَحْنَا لَكَ فَتْحًا مُبِينًا. So the treaty was considered the greatest conquest in this ummah in history. Soon after that, just 2 years later, they entered Mecca victorious, and the whole peninsula became a Muslim place because of this treaty, because Allah knows best. But who has this deep understanding to reflect upon things? Like when the Prophet ﷺ said that one day that he made a statement. Everybody took it as is, while Abu Bakr as-Siddiq started crying. They asked him, why are you crying? He said, don't you get it? This is a message that the Prophet ﷺ is departing this life. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was very special when it comes to understanding the Quran, delivering the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 5 out of the 10 heaven-bound companions, al-ashara mubashareen bil-jannah, have accepted Islam because of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. The hadith, which is narrated by Abdurrahman ibn Auf and others, in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Abu Bakr fi al-jannah, wa Umar fi al-jannah, wa Uthman fi al-jannah, wa Ali fi al-jannah, wa Abu Ubaid ibn al-Jarrah, wa Talha ibn Ubaidillah, the 10 heaven-bound companions. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq recruited to Islam 5 out of the 10. And subhanallah, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أَدَّلُّ عَلَى الْخَيْرِ لَهُ أَجْرُ فَاعِلِ. So these 5 people and others will come in the scale of the good deeds of the Prophet, of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. I can tell you that we can speak about Abu Bakr as-Siddiq all night long, but we ran out of time. I got the message and we have to stick to that. I want to tell you another thing, that the Quran which we have in our hand was compiled at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the house of the Hufaz and written in scriptures. But it was Abu Bakr as-Siddiq who ordered that all the Sahaif to be compiled in one book to preserve this Quran by the leave of Allah. Narrated Al-Bukhari radiallahu anhu from Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam once was standing on the Mount of Uhud, him and Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman. Then there was a little quake. Rajaf al-Jabal, a shock. So the Prophet ﷺ spoke to the mountain and said, Usbut Uhud, stay firm the Mount of Uhud. فَإِنَّمَا عَلَيْكَ نَبِيٌّ وَصُدِّيقٌ وَشَهِيدَانٌ. Those who are standing on you are nothing but a prophet and a Siddiq, Abu Bakr Siddiq, وشهيدان, and 2 martyrs, Umar and Uthman. After the Prophet ﷺ called Abu Bakr Siddiq as-Siddiq, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed many ayat in the Quran concerning him, what do we expect but to love him, the utmost love, exactly as we love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his best companions. May Allah be pleased with all of them. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Jazakumullah khairan.